Hi everyone, welcome at the Virtual Past Summit. Great to have you all at my session today. In this session, I'm going to talk about Comedate Service. You have, I think like many people, heard about Comedate Service, CDS, but not sure how to use it within your organization. Many people are using Power BI, Power Apps, and Power Automate, but still have no clue what Comedate Service does. So I think it's good to know if and how CDS can be a part of a data architecture. And it won't help you at all use cases, but in certain use cases, Comedate Service is the right service to use. So if you're curious about Comedate Service, what it can do for you, you're at the right session here. Okay, so as you might know, this is a recorded session. Well, the advantage is I can answer questions at the same time. So don't hesitate. If you have any questions, put them at the live question board. I'll be answering questions during this presentation. Also, after the presentation, I'll be joining live for a 15 minutes Q&A. Okay, let's get started. First, if you haven't heard about all the local initiatives within the Power within the PaaS community, make sure you get familiar with them and how it can help you learn more and more about your all about data solution, that kind of stuff. And of course, session evaluations. Really interesting, really powerful information for everyone as a speaker, especially during these virtual events. It's good to have some feedback from how it went and how we can improve our presentations. So please don't hesitate to fill in this session evaluation afterwards. Short introduction of myself. My name is Hugo Peek. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm a consultant within the BI analytics, everything what has to do with data, focusing on the Microsoft technology, working from data platforms, data warehousing, and also analytics, and helping organizations to how to use analytics within their data strategy. Okay, so the topics of the sessions. First, Comedate Service as a part of the Power Platform. I think placing Comedate Service in the right position already gives you some idea how CDS is used and can be used for you. And especially if you're already familiar with other components of the Power Platform, like Power Apps and Power BI, this will help you a lot. And well, the biggest part of this presentation is the demo. I believe that seeing stuff helps you the most in understanding what it can do, what it is, and how you should use it, and if you can use a tool like this. So I'm going to show you a lot of stuff during the demo, all different kind of features, the most important features, I think, and so to give you a good overview of Comedate Service and some place we go a little bit more deep dive, but I think that's interesting. Okay, after all that information during the demo, I think it's good to get back and realize when do I want to use Comedate Service. And answering the questions of the title, why isn't it common yet? Okay, so let's get started with CDS as a part of the Power Platform. Well, this is a really widely used image of the Microsoft Power Platform, where you have Power BI as the analytics tool, Power Apps as the application development, Power Automate to automate some processes, and the virtual agent for chatbots. And what they all have the same is that it's focusing on the end user. It's focusing on the business user who doesn't want to code, or maybe a little bit of coding and more like Excel kind of coding. So on Power BI, you have DAX as a query language, and Power Apps and also Power Automate, you've got some coding which looks like Excel for a little bit. But you can do a lot without coding with all those services on top. But to use our services, of course you need data. There are different ways to get data in these services within the Microsoft Power Platform. For example, the data connectors. You get a lot of data connectors, more than 200 different kind of data connectors, so you can get data from files, different kind of files from applications, SaaS applications, but also of course databases, SQL, Oracle, MySQL, all that kind of information you can get into those services by using those data connectors. Of course, you can get data from on-premise and use it within these services. The second one on the bottom, AI Builder, is a way to add extra intelligence based on your data using Comma Data Service, and use the information that AI Builder creates based on your models and use it in the services on top. And the last one is Comma Data Service. So that's, well, it's a data storage. It's a database for end users, and you can use the data within Comma Data Service within all the services on top. It's not just limited to that. You can use the data from Comma Data Service in other applications as well. Well, we see that during the demo. But first, Comma Data Service is tightly related to Power Apps. You can use Comma Data Service without Power Apps, but that doesn't make much sense. So if you're not using Power Apps, you have to think really good before using Comma Data Service. But just to get started with Comma Data Service, it's really close to Power Apps. You will see during the demo, it's part of the Power Apps application online. So to talk a little bit more about Comma Data Service. First of all, it's a database. It's a user perspective database. So you create your data model, you create tables and columns, but we call it entities and fields. So the look and feel, it's more based for create for users, end users, business users. And you can focus more on designing a data model instead of coding and writing SQL queries, for example. And it's mainly a transactional database. You can use the way you want, like every database, but this is a lot of features within Comma Data Services focusing on being a transactional database, especially because you can also build applications on top of Comma Data Service by using Power Apps. Of course, it's in the cloud, but all the advantages Azure provides, like scalability, security with Azure Active Directory integrated. But there's also a lot of integration with other services, and I think that's the big advantage. So it's really easy to get data in if you want to, but especially to get data out by using Azure Data Lake. So that makes it, because an application is not just an application for, the data is not just for the application, but you want to use it for analytics, for example, as well, or to create some other, to use the data as part of another application. So integration is really important. It's like the whole Microsoft Power Platform. It's focused on business users, so it's low-code/no-code platform. But it's mainly low code, I think, but you can do a lot of stuff without even coding at all. So again, you can focus on creating a data model, but also creating objects and business logic, and focusing on data movement by drag and drop and by clicking without coding. And the last one is the metadata that's provided within the Comma Data Service. It's always there. So each entity slash table has its own auditing and logging, and also some change tracking. So that if you want to use the data to incrementally load to a data warehouse or a data lake for further analytics, it's just by clicking one checkbox and you have change tracking enabled, and it will be loading incrementally. So that's all default part of the Comma Data Service. Okay, so I think that's enough for Theory. To start with, let's go to the demo. If you have used Power Apps before, you're familiar with this screen. We are focusing this demo mainly on the data part, of course. We're focusing on combination service. So let's go to the data menu over here, where you have a few other options. We're gonna hit a few of them during this demo. So let's first go to the entities. Let's see what we have over here. Well, we got a lot of entities here, and I only created 4 by myself. So you got a lot of entities free to use within Combinator Service. There, these entities are common entities a lot of organizations use. They're part of the common data model. You might have heard of it. And you can sort them over here. And you can see you got 4 custom types. And the rest of them are all standard types. Let's have a look at one of my entities. I've got product entity with a lot of information. Again, those types, and you see that there are about 10 custom fields, and the rest of them are all standard fields. And those standard fields are part of the auditing and logging capabilities within Combinator Service. So let's see what we can do with entities by adding a new entity. So I'm gonna put in a display name. Let's call it demo products, and it has a technical unique name. Interesting here, of course, when you're used to create database in like SQL or Oracle. You define most of the times a surrogate key. In here, we are defining a business key, a primary key, which is actually a business name. What can be everything you like. You can enter your own integers if you want to, but well, it's a business user database. So we're using functional names over here. Underneath, there are GUIDs created. But we don't have to think about that within CDS. It's been done for you. And of course, there's a technical name as well in the backend. There are a few other options about ownership of this entity and how to work together by creating this data model. But I think interesting here to show is that you have the capability to enable change tracking, which allows you to incrementally export data to the data lake. You'll see later on in this demo. And of course, you have something like duplicate detection, can turn it off and on and off if you want to. So let's create this entity. Now we've got one field, it's called name, which is my primary name field. Let's add another field, description. In the meantime, we saw all the other auditing and logging fields been created, and they're showing on the screen right now. So let's add a display name description for my description field. And you can see that you have different kind of data types, pre-formatted email, URL, phone numbers, kind of data types, auto numbers if you want to, numbers, daytime, and other specially created data types. Here I'm using just text. You have the option to make it optional, so nullability. Of course, but also you can say it's recommended. So when you're using an application based on this data, it will be showing some warning sign when you're not filling in something in, but it won't keep you from updating or inserting data. And you got some other advanced options for each column. So for each data type, different kind of options. But you can, for example, have some field security for privacy sensitive data if you want to. You can enable it here, but you have to manage it in the admin portal of Dynamics itself. So let's click done and save entity. So now we have an entity with actually two custom fields, name and description, and the rest of it is all logging and auditing. One more field I want to create, that's a relation, because of course you have relations in every data model, but it's been created differently here than in a usual database. So let's show how it works. I got an entity named product group. So I want the product group, because a product is part of a product group, I want a product group for each product, to define a product group. So let's call this product group name, for example. Now I can change this data type to over here to lookup. And lookup, well, if you're used to Excel, you know that you got lookup, field lookups. We do a lookup and we're going to look up in some table. And let's select the product group I created before. In this case, it's not optional or recommended, it's required. And, well, that's, I think that's the most important settings you have to set for a relation. Now it's created. Now I'm saving it, and on top you can see relationships over here, which are defined. And you see a lot of them. They're mainly the relations to other entities used for logging and auditing. But over here you got my just created relation, and you can see on top it's demo products is many to one related to product group, and the field within demo products is called product group name. So you got a functional name in the table of the demo products. And here you can set the options for the behavior when a product group in this example will be deleted. What should happen with the product? Should those be deleted or set to nil? All that kind of stuff can be done over here. I created a few other entities, so let's see what you can do within all different kind of fields within those entities. Let's select product, and within product, I have several custom fields. One of them is sales price. So I click sales price, and you can see it's from the data type currency. So I can say it's a decimal, of course, it's a decimal number, but you can also say it's currency, and that allows you to have a automatically used change rate. So if you have a base currency, all your data which are inserted with different currencies will be calculated to the base rate as well. For example, I've got euro as a base rate, but this sales of this application is stored in US dollars, so I store the change rate and it will be automatically calculated for the base rate as well. Another one is default margin. It's a decimal number as a data type. That's not really interesting about default margin, but well, I think it's really interesting here is the calculation, because the default margin is a calculation here. It's more a calculated column instead of a fill-in column. And you might have seen it with the description. When I was entering the description field, you can also use calculated or roll-ups. So let's show both of them. So starting with the calculation. So default margin is a calculation between the two different columns. And you can say which rows should be calculated by this formula. So first you get a condition filtering the rows that should be where this action should be done. So the default margin is the sales price minus the purchase price divided by the sales price. Well, what I noticed here the first time I used this are the technical names I used over here. So yeah, well, hopefully that will change in the future, but you got some intelligence over here, you got functions over here. So if I say put it like this, you got a functional names on the right, but you still have to, you still see the technical names in the formula over here. But this calculated column is calculate immediately after one of those two columns changes, the value of the default margin changes as well. So have a look at the rollup. I created a rollup column at the product group entity. Because product groups have one or more, well, zero or more products, I want to calculate periodically how many products are within a product group. So over here I got a number of products field, and I can open a rollup. That's a calculation as well, but it's a different kind of calculation, a different kind of use calculation. It's more a aggregation instead of a calculation for each row, like the calculated field is. You have more a aggregation calculation, of course, for each row within a product group. But for in this example, I calculate all the related products for the specifically product group. So you can compare this when you're using Power BI. You can compare this with calculate fields or calculate columns. And rollups are more like measures. Not exactly the same, because you cannot do as much as with measures in Power BI, but it's just the same kind of usage. Rollups are not updated immediately after each change. It's you can schedule it in the admin center of Dynamics. So let's close this. I'm done over here. Well, let's have a look at the data. First, I'm going to open the entity product again. Well, first, let's filter over here. Just show me the custom entities I've created. Products. We've seen a lot of fields. We have seen the relationships. Let's have a look at the data. You can see here the data. And well, you can change this view, seeing all the fields. Okay, there's a lot of information. Just select star from table. Instead of I have only the active products and inactive products, they're just created fields where all my products are active. So let me show all the fields of the active products. But I cannot change the data over here. To do that, I go to edit data in Excel. And of course, this is a way to maintain your data and not to use your data in an application. Okay, so it's just the way you click edit data in a SQL Server database, for example. But it's a way to look at your data and filter and see how your data looks like. So you need a add-in, my Excel add-in for Power Apps, so it can load your data. And now you see all my products over here in Excel with all the fields. And you can filter like you used to every Excel table. And for example, you can see here all the product groups for each product. You see the name, of course. Underneath the GUID is stored, but you see the name in the table itself. And if you want to change it, you can just click over here and change in this case, the product group. It's stored at accommodations once you click publish here below. Okay, so if you change something here and then click publish, it's updated in accommodation service. Also, have a quick look at the default margin. For example, we've got 10, the purchase price is 10 and the sales price is 50. That makes the default margin 80%. So if I change this to 5, my default margin will and I click publish, my default margin will go to 0.9, so 90%. So you can see it's calculated immediately after each update. So, but there's something else you can do, a little bit more complex, kind of constraints. So this is our more calculated values, but what about constraints? So maybe you've seen business rules on top here. So let's have a look at the business rules. First, let's go to something else, the sales order details where all the sales lines are stored. Go to business rules. I've got a check discount value. So before I show you the business rule, let's see what happens in the data. Let's click edit data in Excel. I show you stuff in Excel, of course, but when deployed accommodate serves and you're using accommodate serves, you're using it within a Power Apps application. I will show you later on. So again, a new Excel is opened and all the information about the sales orders details are shown in Excel. And I got a check discount value business rule, okay? So what does it do? It's the, it says, it checks when the discount is higher than the sales price. So the product in this example is $14. And discount is 1.5, so the line total is 12.5. That makes sense, okay? So if I accidentally say it's 16 and then click publish, I want an error. Well, it's the same when I have an application where I say it's 16 and the sales price 14, I want an error message to appear. So what happens? I've got a message, discount must be less than the sales price. Well, that's right. So let's change this to 1.6 and then publish. And now you see that it successfully published. And also the line total has been changed to 12.4. So what did happen? Well, how did it happen actually? Well, that was the business rule defined over here. Check discount failure. So I open this one and you see you get a new screen where you can create and manage your business rules. There you go. What I've done is creating a really small, easy to understand business rule. First, it has a condition that checks if the unit discount is greater or equal to the unit sales price. Because I define the condition over here, and then when it's true, do something. When it's false, well, just continue whatever you're doing. So, in this case, to show an error message. There are a lot of other components set over here you can use to do some stuff with fields. You can lock the fields in the screen or set a specific value or hide a field if you want to. In this case, I just show an error message, and underneath below here, you got a text view of the rule you have defined. It can be more complex than what you see over here, but this is the basic idea of the business rule. It's more kind of constraints, business constraints, and it can be a little bit more complex than what you see over here. So let's close the business rules and move on to the next one, and those are the views. So let's go to product again, because of course we have data within our application, but we want also to use the data outside the database, of course. So to do that, we create views in accommodate service. It's like creating views in a database. It's more like the extraction layer of the database. So have a look over here. It's there are a few default views defined, but you can create your own views, of course. So have a look at the active products. One of the views I used for showing all the data before. But you can also use this view for creating applications. So this active products has 5 columns. Is filtered by the purchase price, it's filtered by the active, and is sorted by the purchase price. And I can add a column over here, like the default margin, and change the order, everything of course by clicking. and then save and publish this view so I can use it well within my application. And well, let's make one step closer to the application and create a form that can be used in your application. We're creating a form without coding. So let's go to forms over here and just get one of the default forms you get from CDS. And it shows you a form with all the information of the product in this case. So I can add new fields over here or just drag fields in here. And I can say, well, I'm gonna hide it or lock it or make it visible, read only, all that kind of stuff you can do over here. On the menu on the right. And well, again, you can save and publish this. And this form will be used to do the insert new products, edit products, showing the products as well. So now we've got a form based on a view, and the view is based, of course, on the data which have constraints defined in the business rules. So that allows us to create a model-driven application based on this common data service database. So for creating a model-driven application, we go to apps. Well, let's minimize data. Within the apps menu, we create a new model-driven application. A new screen opens and let's create a demo app fan store pass summit and click done. Here we've got a sitemap. We're going to define which entity should be part of my application. Let's edit this new area, which is fan store. Fan store products information. Edit products and groups. First one will be a product. Let's select an entity. Oh, here you go. Select an entity and make this entity products. Add a new sub area and will be product group. Let's save this sitemap publish. Now you see when I go back to the app designer and below here you see the forms and views will be used which are related to product and product group. So let's save this application and then publish this application. And well, that's all we have to do to create this application. It's a really easy application, but it's a way in this case to maintain my data with a default screen. So I can use the filter below. I can show all the products and say, give me a delete one or add new product. And this is a screen I created or I edited actually. I added the currency and purchase price and sales price over here as well. So you can do a lot of stuff. Well, this is, I cannot change this over here because I locked it during my editing. Well, you can, well, do a lot of more stuff. Of course, you can use an Excel and create a flow here as well. So, and this application can also be used, well, on your mobile phone. You can share it with others who can use this application. So this is, I show you this because it gives you the idea of why you should use, if you want to use CDS, why you should use it, because it's really easy way to create applications for your business users, because it's it gives you default kind of forms and views which you can use. But if you're more if you have a technical unit who develops all the applications, they're probably not gonna use accommodation services as the database, because they're used to a other type of database and they want to have full control about look and feel. But this way you can easily create applications based on your data model. And of course, when editing information over here, the business rules and will be checked here as well. So I cannot enter a new sales order detail with a discount higher than my unit sales price. Okay, so we have seen how to create and edit a data model, extended with some business logic, and also creating forms to use it in an application. So I have now have a look at how we can integrate Comodate service with the outside world of the Power platform, or at least the outside world of Comodate service itself. So first, have a look at getting data from a other application. Okay, so maybe you're familiar with data flows, a way to move data in and out common Microsoft Power Platform. So I'm going to create a data flow. I got a database somewhere with customers. So let's add customers to this database, to the CDS database. So I'm going to create a data flow and call it customers. Now I select SQL database. The server name is SV database.windows.net. I already created this connection before. Next, now you can see my entities tables within my SQL database. They look familiar to the Comodate service, but we don't have a customer in this Comodate service yet. So let's add customer to the Comodate service, transform data. Now you've got a Power Query editor within the data flow, of course. So if you're familiar with that, you recognize all the things I do over here, but this is just the way to change the data flow. So remove columns and add tabs and transform your data. This is all I'm gonna do. I'll click next. And now I get the opportunity to tell Comodate Service tell the data flow what to do with the data to Comodate Service. So first you got load new table, you got a loading existing table, or just do not load the data flow. I'm gonna load the data to a new table. I'm gonna call it customer, but okay. The fun thing is they call it table here, but they're actually entities within Comodate Service, of course. This application database in SQL, SQL database, has a unique primary name field, which actually a primary key, which is ID. So I'm not sure if the name is unique. I can't tell. So if I know it's unique, I can change this to name. I keep it the same over here, like, because that's the disadvantage of integrating data from my external system. It's using the ID field as a unique identifier, and in CDS they're using a name field or business key, actually. So I click next. Then I get the opportunity to how to manage my refresh. So I can refresh manually or also create a flow that is scheduled. So I'm going to schedule this once a day and then click create. So this creates a data flow, and when the data flow executes, I'm just going to execute it. I'm going to refresh the data manually the first time to make sure it happens really fast. So when it's refreshed, you will be seeing the customer over here within my entities. Oh, it's already there. So it's quite fast. Normally it takes about a minute, but that's really good. You can see my customer entity with all the fields I loaded. So you got the custom fields that's loaded from external system, from a database. You got standard fields over here. So that's a way to get your data in from external systems. And as you can see, you saw a lot of, with the connectors, a lot of connectors you can use to insert your data. Besides adding data for a whole entity, you can also update some data in your accommodations, and also data that you can manage within your accommodation service as well. So to be more concrete, I'm going to make an example by using a flow. So I'm using Power Automate to create a flow and insert, update actually some data. What I'm going to do is the exchange rate. Okay, so first let's show you the table currencies over here. There you go, that's the data. I've got two currencies, as I said before. I got Euro as a base currency, and US dollar is actually the currency I'm using for this application, for this store. So it says 1.17 is the exchange rate. So I want to get the daily exchange rate, and then, well, the average, I think, daily exchange rate, and then use that for my application. So when a new item is sold today, it uses the exchange rate of that particular day. So I want to update this every day. So let's go to the flows and add a new flow. New scheduled from blank flow. I'm going to update exchange rate just once a day, create, just to make sure it says once a day. No, it said once a minute. Again, one time a day. And well, I'm gonna add a new step. I'm gonna use some URL where I know I get my exchange rate from. Oh, I'm gonna click this one. It's gonna be a get method. I've got the URL that gives me the JSON file stored, so that I don't have to type the whole URL and make typos, of course. So copy paste. Okay, that will work. And when getting the data, I want to update my common data service. Oh, of course, common data service. I want to update a record, and well, it has to be in the same environment where I'm currently in. Well, that's what I want, is the default environment. The entity name is currencies, currency. Here you go. And I need an identifier of the record. So that's when you update, you have to specify the GUID, actually, where you want to update. Of course, you can make this more dynamic within in flow, and then create it for each loop and find the right row based on the name and make it really easy here. But I'm not going, this GUID is not going to change in my environment. And what I want to do is to update the exchange rate. And I know the format of the JSON, so I'm again over here. I got an expression. It says, give me the body of the HTTP, which is a JSON. Get it, gives back a JSON. And I first get to USD from US dollar, and then get a rate. Click OK, save. And well, just last Let's test. Test. Run flow. Done. And then you see that the output of the HTTP request is a JSON file which it says USD and then the rate. So my rate now should be 1.18434 and so on. So have a look at my data. Currency data. And now it's 1.18434 and so on. So you can integrate data as from the web as well into your common data service, and you can schedule flows, of course, so that it can be done well with the interval you'd like. I want to show you one more thing, and that's how to get data out common data service. So let's go to export to data lake, and now the change tracking is really important here, because you can only move data to data lake automatically by using change tracking set on the entity. So I created a data lake which should be in the same region actually, and the same subscription environment as this common data service. In my case, it's Europe, West Europe, so it should be the same. And then you can see your data lake over here. I already linked a data lake to my common data service environment, and I created exports for four entities. I created for account, which are actually my customers, but then in common data service, product group, sales order details, sales order header. So have a look how it looks like in Azure. Because there's a container used for your common data service data. It's over here. This might automatically created a container by linking the data lake, and that's important because I want to do something with the data. I want to use Power BI to extract data from the data lake. So I cannot extract Power BI extract common data service from to Power BI directly. I'm going to use data lake. So let's have a look at the URL. I need a URL from the data lake store. I'm going to copy it. I'm going to open Power BI, and I want to use the data from common data service. Okay, so get data from a database, another source. And select Azure Data Lake Storage Gen 2, connect. Got my URL, and I need a container as well. So let's go back to my container, copy this one. Here you go. I'm going to use the CDM. Folder view, because well, the data moved to Azure Data Lake is incrementally loaded based on changes. So if nothing changed, nothing is loaded. But if something changed, just the changes are loaded to Data Lake. But I just want the current view of the data. So that's what the CDM does. So if I'm gonna look over here, I got all the five entities within my CDM folder. There you go. With all the technical names over here for each entity. Over here I got the same, but I don't have the option to select something. So I have to do that from my CDM folder. And select all of them. And then click load. I, of course, transform data or do all the stuff you would like to do. I'm just going to show now how you can add the data to a Power BI by using the data lake store and moving data automatically from CDS to the data lake. So well, it will be loaded, don't worry about that. So let's go back to the slides actually, and have a look what we have done so far. Let's have a look what we've seen in the demo. Well, we have configured, of course, our data model by creating entities, adding fields, creating relationships. We have also seen how business rules works. We checked the discount value and how it affects the data manipulation. We created views to extract our data to a external environment of CDS, so we can use it in Power Apps in this case. Of course, we need forms, how the application should look like. We got a lot of default forms used. We also edited the data using Excel to edit the data. And then we created also, of course, a model-driven application based on the data model we created. And with just a few clicks, and you have a model-driven app which you can share and people can use. Also use the data flow to import customer data and schedule it so that it can be refreshed with a given interval. But also exported the data to the data lake to use it outside Kubernetes service, for example, for analytics in Power BI. We also, it's not on the sheet, but we also created a flow within Power Automate to update data, in this case for the currency. And again, it's scheduled, so it, with a given interval. So there are a lot of other features within accommodations. A few of them, which we haven't discussed, is the integration of AI models, where by using AI Builder, you can you create models and then use the data and accommodation service to add some information, get some more information of the data by using those models. And then use the data output for the models in your services, like Power Apps, for example. We also have the opportunity to expand our model-driven application with dashboards and charts, more analytical kind of purposes. We just created forms, but also you can create dashboard and charts and then use it in your model-driven application. And also more focusing on the collaboration and sharing your environment within a Power Platform, you can create and share solutions. You can share your Kubernetes service model, but you can share everything within Power Apps actually. Also your applications, your data flows and that kind of stuff. All the features, they're really interesting with the Power Platform and Kubernetes service. So when do I want to use CDS, knowing what we've seen now during the demo? Well, when to use CDS, you have to know when to use connectors, for example, because connectors are the other option actually to use data. Well, you get a lot of connectors. And they're especially interesting when you have your data already stored somewhere. You're not gonna move your data to CDS just because you want to use CDS. Keep your data where it already exists. Especially if you're integrating different sources to a application, to a Power Apps application, use Power Apps connect or the connectors to load data to Power Apps. So. And also, when you have on-premise data, of course, and you want to keep your data, well, most of it on-premise, well, you can use connectors with a gateway in between to move only data, to use only data you want, you allow to be in Azure in your application, but just in the application itself, not in CDS. And there are a few features that connectors is not allowed with connectors, like the powered model. Creating a model that easy is not an option with connections, and sharing secure access with your data to external users with Power Portals and AI Builder is not available with connectors. And of course, everything you can do with Comodate Service, of course. And also interesting in knowing if you want to use Comodate Service is the pricing. Because pricing is really important, especially the first question people ask if you're talking about Power Apps or Power BI or Comodate Service. So you get two different kind of licenses, like per user and per app. And well, the Power App licensing and Comodate Service is part of it, what the two at the bottom are mainly focusing on, Comodate Service. You're tied to two applications when you have a per app license. But in general, just for first use, that's enough, but two is not that much. So soon you have to use a per user license. And so it will be $40 a month for each one who's creating application. Also, the users are paying needs a license at paying $10 a month. And if they're using three or more applications, they have to pay $40 a month. And if the capacity is not enough in your Comodate Service, you can buy extra capacity for $40 a month per gigabyte. Okay, so knowing all this, why is Comodate Service still not coming? Well, I think you should use Comodate Service when you embrace Power Apps and you use Power Apps to build simple applications and having applications that generate new data. So as I said, use connectors if you have already data stored somewhere and want to use the data for applications. You can build really complex applications within Power Apps, but Comodate Service is the big advantage of Comodate Service is to create model-driven applications really fast. And well, those model driven applications are more simple kind of application. That's okay. You probably need lots of them. But that's the kind of use case Comodate Service comes in. And also the master data is, I think, a thing that you hear quite often these days. Because a master data service not a part as a service doesn't exist in Azure. So this is a good alternative to have your master data services in Azure. And of course you have things like business rules, and you can even managing your data and storing your master data in Comodate Service and building really easy to use forms and in Power Apps with your model driven application. You can use it as your master data tooling in the cloud. But the thing is, Comodate Service is an end-user database. It's especially designed for end-users. But the most users I've seen using Power Apps, I think the 95% of the users I've seen using Power Apps are developers or have a developing background. So those people are used to use databases like SQL, Oracle, MySQL, and that kind of databases. It's for them, it's a big step to change to Comodate Service. But if you are a business user and not used to create database, write scripts and all that kind of stuff, Comodate Service can be really powerful. But yeah, the most users using Power Apps are developers. And also, the last one is that licensing of the whole Power Platform and the slides you saw before just for the Power Apps part are aimed for a self-service as a strategic choice within an organization. It's relatively expensive to create one app and then use Comodate Service for it. Okay, so or maybe three apps and use Comodate Service for it. Because everyone who uses the three apps has to pay $40. And just using it maybe temporarily, that's for those applications, it's okay, but that can be really expensive. If you're embracing self-service within your organization, it makes more sense to use Comodate Service as your database. And it's okay if you pay $40 a month for extra capacity, for example, and for every user using Comodate Service and Power Apps. Okay, well, thank you for your time and thank you for joining the session. Well, we're going to the live Q&A, so I hope that you have a better idea what CDS can do for your organization and how it can help you. So thank you again and see you at the live Q&A.